today we are going to wrap up that discussion, and we are also going to talk about IR and Raman activity. Of normal modes of vibration. Very strange. Okay, that is what we are going to talk about today. But before that, I asked you to do something at home. How many of us have worked it out? Okay, good boy. Fine. So, what we do today is, we discuss those examples which you must have worked out last night. What you have done is, you have worked out the symmetries of normal modes of vibration, and hopefully you have worked out what are the internal, what is the contribution of internal coordinates to these modes, right. So, maybe I will just clarify something that seemed to leave a doubt in your mind yesterday. What we said is that you have AG, was it AG or A1? A1, you have a stretch as well as bend, right. So, we had said that it has to be A1 plus minus right, stretch plus minus A1 bend. Maybe I should clarify this a little bit. This is a linear combination, right. So, what we are saying is this, xi is equal to maybe A stretch, A1 stretch plus A bend, A1 bend. Okay. Now, these one of these coefficients can be 0. We are not saying that it can never be 0, but the general solution is that it is a linear combination of both. That is why we said that you expect the normal mode to be opening up while stretching, that is one, and the other is closing down while stretching. Now, how much of contribution of stretch and how much contribution of bend will be there? That depends on these coefficients, right. So, a special case would be one of the coefficients is 1, the other is 0. Then it will be a pure stretch or a pure bend, but this is the general solution, right. And the magnitude of the coefficients depends on things like the force constant and atomic weight. That is something that we will not be able to cover in this course. For that, you have to actually work out the Wilson's FG matrix and move over to what are called the symmetry coordinates. We will not be able to do that in this course, unfortunately, but that is what I thought. I'll make a point so that there is no confusion. Okay, this is a general solution. Okay. So, today we want to talk about IR activity and Raman activity of normal modes. Of course, whoever has studied CH442 or an equivalent molecular spectroscopy course would already know this. It would be revision for them. Shantanu.
I have a doubt from class.
Yeah.
What is the use of those redundant?
There is no use. They are redundant. You throw them away. See why they arise. They arise because we are taking a coordinate that is not there. Okay. We are considering the three angles, and we are getting the redundant coordinate that we always get is totally symmetric, and it is impossible that all the angles will increase at the same time if it is like BF3 in a plane. If you have worked out the example of the tetrahedron CH4, there also you would have encountered a similar totally symmetric bending vibration which is redundant. For things like ammonia, the problem is not there, because it can expand, there is no issue. All angles can increase at the same time. But if there is a fourth bond like in CH4, if this increase takes place, then automatically these angles become smaller. It is not possible for these angles to increase also. So, that is why you get a redundant coordinate in a system which is say tetrahedral or a system that is 83H. For C3V, there is no problem. All right. So, redundant system arises out of taking one coordinate too many, but then as you saw yesterday, if you do not take that one coordinate too many, it is very difficult to formulate the problem. That is why we take it and then we eliminate it at an appropriate time. Okay, let us think of, let us take a character table, any character table. Which character table do you like? The one that is showing up. Huh? Which character table do you like? It wouldn't matter, okay? It wouldn't matter really. Huh. So let us say C4V. Now suppose I use XYZ as basis. Does it describe everything? It only gives you an idea of E and A1 symmetric species. So we want to study IR activity and Raman activity. Today I will not miss the end point. This is fine. Now, what is the meaning of IR activity? What is the meaning of Raman activity? I think many of you have at least some kind of molecular spectroscopy course has been studied by everybody. So, you tell me. We are talking about vibrations, right? In what kind of spectroscopy do we see vibrations? Infrared spectroscopy, right? What other kind of spectroscopy can we use to see vibration? We can use what is called Raman spectroscopy. Has everybody here know about Raman spectroscopy? If not, do not be shy to say that. Today we do not have to finish at 6:30. Okay. We will just give a very brief idea of Raman spectroscopy. It is like this. Let us say these are vibrational levels of a molecule in the ground electronic state, okay. And let us say you now hit the molecule with a laser of some particular wavelength nu, all right. Then what will happen? The molecule will want to get excited. Let us say you start from here. Of course, if these are vibrational levels, it is not very easy to start from here at room temperature, but just so that we perform a complete discussion, let us say that this is a manifold of states and I initiate an upward transition from here. Okay, but let us say you know about stationary states. What are stationary states? Probability density is invariant with time. Very good. Any other way of defining stationary state? Energy does not change with time, right? That was actually Bohr's definition, that these are states in which the energy does not change with time. So, stationary not with respect to space, but with respect to energy, constant energy states. So, these are stationary states. What are non-stationary states? States whose energy changes with time, right? So, if the energy changes with time, the issue is that you cannot have your molecule stay in those states for too long. Okay. So, now I have, let us say this is the manifold and the next higher manifold is there at 20,000 centimeter inverse, right. However, I have hit this with a laser whose energy is 15,000 centimeter inverse. What will happen? The molecule will not reach the next stationary state, but it will try, right. It will try because molecule has not studied quantum mechanics. So, it does not know that it is not supposed to absorb this photon, putting in very, very simple terms, of course, right. So, what it will do is, it will try, but then it won't reach a stationary state, but there are like many non-stationary virtual states in between. So, it is going to reach a virtual state, okay. Without getting into any math, we can perhaps develop some very qualitative idea about virtual states. If you think of a game of basketball, Okay? You have the ball, you have the basket is there, the ball is in your hand. If you hold it and stand, that is your ground state. Okay? Unless you tire, the ball is going to be in your hand forever. So, lifetime is infinite. Okay? You throw the ball in the right direction with right energy, what happens is it enters the basket, gets entangled in the net, so stays there for a very small time and then it falls. So, it has a finite lifetime there. So, the basket is analogous to a stationary state but an excited state. However, if you throw it with not enough energy, then what will happen? The ball will reach some height depending on how hard you have thrown it, and then it will go up and it will come down, right? So, its maximum height that it is reaching is analogous to a virtual state, zero lifetime, all right? And then you can reach the excited state only if you throw the ball with a particular energy in a particular direction. However, you can reach an infinite number of virtual states in between, right, depending on how hard you throw the ball. So, it is something like that, of course, not completely analogous. And the other way you could think is that what happens when light is absorbed? A transition takes place, right? Electron goes from some molecular orbital to another molecular orbital, right? So, we can think that what happens essentially, very qualitatively once again, when a photon impinges on a molecule is that the electron cloud starts getting distorted, right? Let us say this is the ground state MO and let us say this is the excited state MO. The shape is going to change from here to here upon excitation. So, it starts getting distorted, but if you have not given it enough energy, what it does is it gets distorted to the maximum extent possible and then it comes back. But it cannot go beyond, it cannot stay like this. It would have stayed like this if you had given enough energy, because that is a stationary state. You have not given enough energy, so it starts getting distorted and then it comes back also immediately. Okay? That is virtual state. All right? So far so good. So, one thing that this last example brings out is the importance of polarizability, isn't it? If the electron cloud is polarizable, then you can do this very easily. If it is not so polarizable, you cannot do it very easily. So, polarizability has got to do with Raman spectroscopy, and it comes out very elegantly if you perform a classical treatment of this Raman effect problem. But that, let that be the story for another day, if at all. Okay? For now, I think you understand this diagram, right? It goes to a virtual state and then it comes down. Now, if I go back to the basketball analogy, just thrown it, right? It has gone up there, comes down, right? I can reach out and catch the ball a little higher, right? Or I could catch it lower. Depending on whether I catch it higher or lower, what will happen is the energy that is lost by the ball will be more or less than the energy that I had provided, right? Same thing can happen here. Suppose while it comes down to this state. Then what will happen? Energy of this state, energy that is emitted of the photon is going to be less than the energy of the photon that you had provided, right? So, what kind of shift do you get? You get a red shift. So, this kind of a line is called a Stokes line. The name of the guy was Stokes, not Stoke. So, please do not write Stoke apostrophe S. Poor chap will be turning in his grave. Stokes, one word, no apostrophe, Stokes shift. Okay. What is the length of this? 5 centimeter. What is the length of this? Say 4 centimeter. So, if centimeter is just a map of energy, then 4 centimeter is lower energy than 5 centimeter, and this is even lower, no? That is also Stokes shifted. Got it? Stokes shift. But it can be the other way around as well. I can catch the ball a little lower. Here also, the way I have drawn it, you have levels that are lower in energy. So, if the system comes down to a lower level, then what will happen? The energy of the light will be greater than the energy of the light that you have provided. This is you will get a blue shift, and this will be called an anti-Stokes shift. There was no such scientist named anti-Stokes. I am sure there are plenty of people who are anti the Stokes guy, but this is just, you know, Stokes shift and anti-Stokes shift. Understood? So now if I draw, what I can do is instead of drawing these absolute frequencies, I can draw delta nu. I can plot intensity versus delta nu. What is the meaning of delta nu? Whatever is the frequency here minus this frequency, nu minus nu 0, all right? So let us say this is a 0 line. Will you get a line at delta nu equal to 0? Yes, the strongest line will be at delta nu equal to 0. But that is not the Raman line, it is called the Rayleigh line. This is something that is known. This was known before. See, Raman was younger than Rayleigh actually. So Rayleigh came to this world earlier and he discovered the easy thing earlier. Okay, delta nu equal to 0, that is Rayleigh line. Okay, you put in 400 nanometer light, you get out 400 nanometer light, it is just scattered. Raman observed the more difficult thing. He observed lines like this. This side will be what, Stokes or anti-Stokes? Delta nu is increasing this way. So, negative here, positive here. This is Stokes or anti-Stokes. The good thing about writing Stokes first is that you can write anti over it. Anti-Stokes. And what about this? This is of course Stokes line. Now, if you are talking, so what do I get here? What do this delta nu stand for? Don't they stand for the gaps in between vibrational levels? So this is kind of vibrational spectrum of the molecule if these are vibrational levels. Of course, if these are vibrational levels, then it is extremely difficult to observe these anti-Stokes lines because only the zeroth level is populated. So you can get Stokes shift, but not anti-Stokes shift so easily if you are working on simple Raman spectroscopy. All right? Okay, question? Fourth year undergraduates, question, because you have not studied this yet, I think. All right? Okay, fine. Now, not to say that anti-Stokes lines can never be observed for vibrational levels, okay? It can be observed by special techniques. There is something called CARS, where what you do is you amplify the anti-Stokes lines, the coherent anti-Stokes shift is observed there, but that is different. Okay. Stokes is very easy to observe. Now, what is the difference between IR and Raman spectroscopy? Do you see the same lines in IR and Raman? No, not always. That is what we will slowly learn today, why you do not. Now, what is important for IR spectroscopy is dipole moment. What is important for Raman spectroscopy is polarizability.